Hello and welcome to the episode 3 of What a Fab Day. I am your host, Simon Mas. Today, we have a birthday, a tour that begins, and a bit of a commotion. Let's start with the birthday wishes. George Harry Martin, the man that produced almost all the Beatles sessions, helping to shape their sound in the studio, was born on the 3rd of January 1926 in Holloway, near London, England. The importance of Martin in the Beatles' career is hard to overstate. He was the one signing the band when it seems that nobody in the British music business wanted to give them a chance. He was the creator of some tasteful arrangements for their songs, for Yesterday, Eleanor Rigby, I Am the Walrus, and others. But most importantly, he shared their taste for experimentation with a can-do attitude that sometimes resulted in unorthodox solutions that accomplished tasks that seemed theoretically impossible. To cite just one example, in 1967, John Lennon wanted to fuse the two different completed takes of Strawberry Fields Forever to create one single master take. When Martin pointed out to him that the takes were incompatible, having different tempos and tonality, he simply told him to come up with something. And he did. Martin and sound engineer Jeff Emerick accomplished the task with a careful use of tape editing and speed manipulation, something never done before. His role in our story, as you will see, is a very important one indeed. But let's refocus on the Beatles themselves. On the 3rd of January 1962, the band, featuring Pete Best on drums, performed twice at the Cavern Club in Liverpool. The usual lunchtime concert between 12 noon and 2 p.m., and an evening dance event that also featured Johnny Sandon and the Searchers, and King Size Taylor and the Dominoes. It was their first engagement at the venue for the year, and the 15th time that the Beatles had performed a lunchtime and an evening gig there on the same day. On this date, in 1963, the amended four-night Scottish tour of the Beatles finally started, after the band had been stuck in Aberdeen by bad weather. Reaching the Two Red Shoes ballroom in Elgin was not easy either, due to the snow-covered roads, but it could and was accomplished. The band received £42, about £760 in 2020 money, for their engagement. The ballroom, opened in 1960 as a jazz venue, was L-shaped, meaning that part of the audience couldn't actually see the Beatles perform. Moving on to 1964, on this day there was a diplomatic incident between the Beatles manager Brian Epstein and the BBC. You see, in August 1963, the Beatles had taken part to the filming of a BBC documentary called The Mercy Sound, aired in November 1963. Today, in the United States, the NBC's Jack Parr Show broadcasts a snippet of the documentary showing the Beatles performing She Loves You. This first appearance of the Beatles on American national TV was preceded by quite a commotion, as Brian Epstein wrote threatening letters to the BBC, claiming that the sale of the documentary and its airing from NBC could jeopardize the Beatles' exclusive contract with CBS and their live appearances on the Ed Sullivan Show. The BBC had tried to buy back the rights from NBC without success and ended up paying £225, about £4,600 in 2020 money, to the band as compensation. Epstein was nevertheless furious and threatened to forbid any appearance of the Beatles on the BBC in the future. But he must have known that following through on the threats would have damaged the band and himself, as well as the BBC. Anyhow, the NBC broadcast only increased the interest for the Fab Four throughout the United States, nicely leading to their appearance on the Ed Sullivan Show. Even if, in a New York Times article appearing at the time, journalist Jack Gold commented that, and I quote, "It would not seem quite so likely that the accompanying fever known as Beatlemania will also be successfully exported. On this side of the Atlantic, it is dated stuff." Back in London, meanwhile, the ninth night of the Beatles Christmas show went on as usual at the Astoria Cinema. On the 3rd of January 1969, the Beatles are at the Twickenham Film Studios for the second day of rehearsals for the Get Back TV special and the filming thereof. Ringo Starr's Taking a Trip to Carolina, included on the Fly on the Wall disc coming with early copies of Let It Be Naked, was tried out today, along with another of his songs, Picasso. George Harrison and Paul McCartney also performed some of their work in progress. After John Lennon's late arrival, the band turned its attention to old rock and roll standards, a familiar repertoire from the Cavern and Hamburg days, from a mere 6 or 7 years earlier. The band then tried its hand on some of its recent material, I'm So Tired with Paul on vocals, Obladi Oblada, and finally, a new, nearly completed Don't Let Me Down. During the first take of the song, John inserted a bit of Happiness is a Warm Gun in the new material. The day also saw the Beatles returning to some Lennon-McCartney oldies like One of the 909, Won't You Please Say Goodbye, Get on the Phone, I'll Wait Till Tomorrow, and others. The day ended with Maxwell's Silver Hammer, with McCartney calling out the chords as he was teaching the song to the others. A sequence of this, shot today, can be seen in the Let It Be film. Anyhow, the complete list of songs, including fragments that were tried out today, include The Long and Winding Road, Oh Darling, Maxwell's Silver Hammer, Adagio for Strings by Samuel Barber, Tea for Two Cha-Cha by Tommy Dorsey, Chopsticks by Euphemia Allen, Torchy the Battery Boy by Paul McCartney, Whole Lot of Shaking Going On by Jerry Lee Lewis, Let It Be, Taking a Trip to Carolina by Ringo Starr, Please Mrs. Henry by Bob Dylan, Picasso by Ringo Starr, Hey Jude, All Things Must Pass by George Harrison, Don't Let Me Down, Cracking Up by Bo Diddley, All Right, Man, Ocean Cup by Elvis Presley, Your True Love by Carl Perkins,
just,
These Sweet Shoes
just
by Carl Perkins,
chill.
Going in the Wind by Bob Dylan, The Seal by Ethan
Hold
Hitchin,
on, man. Stop. Order. Just chill, like, slow down. Sorry, that was a cheap trick. But honestly, I don't think I should go on with this level of detail in the next few episodes. Either your naughty fans have got your hands on the illegal bootlegs and then you know what was going on, or there is no use listing 50 to 60 songs you will never be able to hear. I will just put a link to the whole list of songs performed during the Get Back rehearsals in the description, so that those who really want it can get it in writing. And now, let's get back to business, concluding the episode with the last of today's entries. On the 3rd of January 1970, George Harrison, Paul McCartney and Ringo Starr were at the EMI studios between 2:30 p.m. and 12:15 a.m. to tape 16 takes of the rhythm track of I Me Mine. The song was to be featured in the Get Back film, in a scene in which George showed it to Ringo while rehearsing at Twickenham after composing it the night before. In order for the song to be included in the album, now meant to be a soundtrack for the film, the song had to be properly recorded, with further overdubs of electric piano, electric guitar, and organ. The completed track lasts for 1 minute and 34 seconds. After take 6, the trio performed an instrumental jam, and after take 11, George Harrison guided the other two through a rendition of Peggy Sue Got Married by Buddy Holly. This indicates that the three did still enjoy playing together, and that the session also had playful moments. Having said that, leaves me with the only task of reminding you to visit www.simonmas.com/support to find out ways in which you can support me and my music-related projects, including this podcast. If you like the podcast, please also consider telling your friends about it. And as usual, the description features links to buy the sources I've used for this episode through the Amazon affiliate program, plus a clip to watch Mr. Jack Parr reminiscing about the infamous 1964 NBC broadcast and the broadcast itself. For the moment, I wish you a good day and a fab continuation.
Simon Mas, music you love.